Hi everyone, welcome to today's Our Community Stories. This is another edition or event about Hayti. This has been a couple of months in the making. So thank you to Hilda Smith, who's kind of our main and lead speaker and organizer for today, for joining us and sharing about this community that she has lived in her entire life. And it's a community that we hear a lot about in Durham. And we're really thankful to have opportunities like this to be able to share and try to hold on to more of the memories of this community and continue to kind of help paint the vision for how we hope that it will become again. In the flyer this month, we had photos. These are all Hilda's family photos, which is really exciting to be able to have such personal memories and see them. And then you'll get to hear more about them today. As always, this series is a part of our community story series. I think we're almost to 30 episodes. If you haven't seen all of them, please look on our YouTube page, or you can find more information on our website, durhamcommunityengagement.org. We featured communities like Hayti. We did an early Hayti one. We've done Walltown, Merrickmore, Bragtown, Brookstown, Crest Street, so many. So please be sure to check that out. And we are always looking for speakers. There are so many other communities that we would like to learn more about. The hardest part is finding speakers. So if you have recommendations or suggestions of anyone that would be able to speak about communities in Durham, it doesn't have to be just a neighborhood. We've had Durham College or the Lincoln Hospital School of Nursing on. We've had the Algonquin Club. So it could be other forms of community. Please let us know, because again, these memories are fleeting, and we want to be able to hold on to them as much as possible. So today we have Hilda on currently. We did a really amazing practice with Mr. Lee. So maybe Hilda, you can tell us a little bit about Mr. Lee in a moment, but he is not feeling well today, so he's not able to join us. And we are hoping that Hilda's brother, Milton, will be able to join shortly. So that may be a surprise coming up in the next few minutes. But in the meantime, Hilda has a lot to share. And so she is gonna get us started. So Hilda, I'll turn it over to you. I might stay on or come on to ask questions, but please just, yeah, we'd love to hear. There's so many memories that you've shared with me already in our rehearsals. I'd love for other people to hear them. So I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Laura. And thanks to the Neighborhood Improvement Services for giving us the opportunity to tell our community stories throughout Durham, not just Hayti. I grew up in the Hayti area, 610 South Elm Street. You will notice the picture on the left that says Hayti 1950s. Elm Street is at the very bottom. And it was surrounded by St. Joseph Street. A part of St. Joseph is still in existence, but the part that was a block away from South Elm is no longer in existence. A lot of the other streets are no longer there. Mobile Avenue, Ray Place. At first, Ray Place was named Ray Alley, and then they changed the name, gave it a little more sophistication to Ray Place. Henry Street, Branch Place, all of those streets were dirt streets, were not paved. all of them connected to either Federal Street or to Pettigrew Street. None of those streets exist now except for Pettigrew, Lakewood, I think all of the other streets are no longer there, as I said, except for Old St. Joseph Street, which is near the church, St. Joseph Church. Well, it's not the church anymore. It's now Hayti Heritage Center, where the old St. Joseph is. Where I lived on Elm Street, it's no longer in existence, but a part of Elm Street does exist where the EMS department now resides, but that's not the end where I grew up on. The end where I grew up on in the 600 block was raised during urban renewal or urban removal. As you see now, Hayti in the 2008 picture, where all of the houses were in the 1950s, there is just vast land or parking lots in the 2008 picture. All of those homes were torn down. Some of those streets housed businesses on Pettigrew and on Fayetteville Street. You see none of those in the Hayti 2008 picture. There was the promise that these businesses would be restored. However, what came in its place was Tin City, which were 10 buildings with some businesses, and later Fayetteville Street Projects before the name Fayette Place was given to it. Okay, you see some of the houses on Elm Street. These houses were located near St. Joseph Street. The end I stayed on, as I said, was 610. That was closer to Fayetteville Street. If you see the rent prices at that time, $1.50 a week or $3.50 a week. During that time, some of the families found it very difficult to even pay that rental rate. And I remember that rent was collected on a card, like a book, like. The landlords would come around and collect rent in a book or on a card with your name, and it showed what you paid and how much you were behind. We were fortunate in that my mother worked, and my father was one of the first African-American long-distance truck drivers for Colonial Stores. So I never remember our rent being behind, but I do remember that other families' rent was behind. And the first picture on the left were what they called the shotgun houses. It was three-room houses. You could stand at the front and look all the way to the back. And that's what they called a shotgun house. Some of the houses, as you can see, had the broken fences or were in need of repair. But as children, some of the residents did not see this as a blighted area. We saw it as home where the families coexisted, where a neighbor across the street from us baked pies and cakes and took it to the business owners on Fayetteville Street and sold them for a small amount of money. We saw it as being out on Elm Street at night skating, riding bikes, just mingling with the neighborhood children, but we knew not to veer too far from home once the street lights came on. This picture on the left is a picture of my mother sitting on a swing on our front porch at 610 South Elm. There were very few swings on porches. As I said, if some of the houses were shotgun houses, there was no room for a swing. And she's dressed. The women of that day were always dressed. The right-hand picture are my two brothers. And you will see behind them a table with a lamp. Under that lamp is a starched scarf. I remember the scarves being dipped in starch and water and then formed so that they were this stiff material. And they would just stand up by themselves, and you could put a lamp or any other decorative object in the middle of them. I hadn't seen this in a while, but the starch scarves were always stuck straight up because of the starch that was put in them. They were allowed to sit outside and dry so that they were in peaks and would just hold any object that you put there. The couch reminded me of how we would sit on, well, this was in the living room, so we very seldom sat in the living room. And that couch is made up of what some of us call pleather today, plastic and leather. If you sat on that couch long enough without a couch cover, you would be wet from perspiration when you got up. But that was the type of material that was in the houses that day. The TVs were black and white, but in order to have a semblance of a color TV, we had this plastic shield that we would put over the TV. It would be blue at the top for the sky, green at the bottom for grass, and then color in the middle just to show the characters moving on the TV. That was our color TV. And you place that on the monitor, and that's what you looked at. Some TVs had an antenna so that if there was static, you could get your TV reception quite well. The left-hand side is my grandmother. She was born in Caswell County in 1897. Here she is walking in downtown Durham. And behind her is the old Central Carolina Bank that was there for years. And then to her left would be the beginning of Woolworth stores. All of those were on the left-hand side of the street. If you notice her attire, a dress, a hat, and an umbrella, always that attire for the elders. An umbrella was carried in the event of sun. It was also carried in the event of rain. That was just a part of the attire for African-American women in that day, who were going downtown to pay bills or to catch the bus to work. The right-hand picture is a picture of my mother. You will also notice a hat on her head, an umbrella in her left hand. This was on Umstead Street, which was going to become the home of Fayetteville Street Projects. If you notice, the street was dirt. And you see all of the woods, the wooded area on that side of the street. We had a house across the street from the wooded area. As I said, this was pre-Federal Street. So we were asked to move from South Elm Street. We found a house on Umstead Street, exact same house number, 610. But the area was not even ready for development because the streets were still dirt. There was still the wooded area, all of those areas, Whitted Street, Grant Street, all of those streets that soon housed Fayetteville Street projects had not been raised to develop housing for low-income residents. Some of the residents could not find housing, so they moved other places out of town where they had relatives. So as I said, urban removal really caused some hardships for a lot of the Hayti residents. And I might add that at this time, Hayti really wasn't considered the areas down near North Carolina Central or Fayetteville Street where the Stanford L. Warren Library now resides. We thought of Hayti as from St. Joseph Street to Elm to Mobile Avenue, Cazart, all down through Pettigrew. But now it seems that the historians have expanded that area to cover a larger area for Hayti. North Carolina North Carolina College at that time was its name, was considered Pearson Town, but it's no longer considered a Pearson Town area now. So there have been different stories about what actually comprised Hayti. Okay, for the nursery school, Scarborough Nursery, which is where my brothers and I attended. I can't remember very many of the kids in my neighborhood attending nursery school, but in the back, that first picture, it's a picture of Scarborough Nursery's rhythm band. And that majorette, the first little girl, majorette, she was related to the Scarboroughs. My brother Milton is standing right next to her. In front of them is someone from North Durham. I remember his name was Michael Soot. So it wasn't just the Hayti children who attended this nursery school. The second photo is a photo of Scarborough Nursery's graduation class. And you see the kids with the diplomas, and Milton is the second kid on the back row next to Mr. Blue. Next to Milton is Nathaniel White. His father ran a printing service down on Pettigrew. I see Milton is connecting. Milton, can you hear us?
I can now, yes.
Okay, I was just showing the pictures of Scarborough Nursery School with the nursery school band and the graduation class where you were part of it. Can you see the pictures?
Yeah, I see myself and the band, and Joe Williams, who has passed, and I think that's I'm on the back row beside the majorette, and I see Joe Williams, as I said, and a lot of the other ones I don't recognize.
Yeah, Nathaniel White is next to you in the graduation class. His father ran Service Printing Company.
Right.
There.
Nathaniel White on the forward picture, he's standing beside me, right beside me. Beside him is Patricia
Lyons.
Lyons, right, thank you.
And I saw a chat pop up to ask if that was the same Scarborough Nursery with the funeral home. Yes, it was. The mother of Skeepy Scarborough is the one who started the nursery school, Lydia, L-Y-D-I-A Scarborough. Very tall, stately.
You have to speak louder. You know I can't hear well. Is that as loud as it can get?
Yeah, turn it.
Yeah, normally when I sit in my class, I'm right up in it.
Okay,
you go ahead. You're fine, you're fine. I just need to move my chair over.
So, and this is our Scarborough Nursery School picture. I am on the back row. The 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the 6 kids sort of in the middle. I see some kids, Leon Creed. I see Sarah Scarborough, a couple of them. The one on the end, back row, was Biff Henderson. He used to work with the David Letterman show. And the bottom right on the end is Luther. I can't remember his last name, but I just remember a few of these kids' faces.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of them grown on and gone by now.
Yes.
It's a blessing to be here.
Hillside High School Marching Band. In this picture was Joseph Mitchell, very renowned musician, very talented. And if I'm not mistaken, that looks like Larry Scurlock, who was a drum major at that time. I also played in the band.
Yeah, you did.
Everyone flopped from near and far when Hillside Band was performing.
Well, known from all around the world, Hillside Band.
And especially the Christmas parade downtown. When we lived in Hayti, we did not have to even go downtown hardly for anything because we had grocery stores. We had Cut Rate Grocery Store. We had Johnson's Fish Market. We had barbershops, beauty parlors, beauty supply stores, shoe shine parlors, restaurants. So the only time that we really would go downtown would maybe be to pay a bill or to see the Hillside Marching Band. Our community had everything it needed in that one hole, so to speak.
We even had, it was a Long's Florist, you know, had our own florist shop, Long's Florist. I remember them. I used to get, when we went to parties and get a boutonniere from Long's Florist. I remember them. And we didn't have to go downtown. Mr. Watkins had a tail shop. You didn't have to go downtown for hardly anything. Everything was right there in Hayti. Everything, banking services, if you went downtown, you probably didn't go any further than called Sears and Roebuck back then. I remember they used to sell dirt. And I thought that was the strangest thing that company Sears used to sell dirt. They had pallets of dirt out that they were selling. And no farther than a company called Montaldo's, where the courthouse is now. So that was Hayti was it was known that soldiers from Fort Bragg used to come to Hayti because that's where everything was. You didn't have to go downtown for hardly anything. You could buy furniture right in Hayti. It was self-supporting.
Do you remember the coal yard right there, that intersection of Pettigrew and Fayetteville?
McGee's Coal Yard. But what I used to remember also, the Duke University, they had coal-fired furnaces, and the great big railroad cars would come through, you could, and they would park them at Pettigrew at Grant. Now you could, you couldn't climb on them, but if the coal fell off of it, you could glean it. And we would, you'd go over there and pick up coal that was landing. It was, they piled the railroad cars high with coal. And we'd go over there and get that coal and bring it back. And Richard and all of them, they even sell it. It was free, but they would pick it up off the ground and sell it to folks and give it to people. They parked the trains down in East, well, it's East Durham, which is right beside Hayti. And Mr. Hill, you remember the man that had the moving company?
McCoy.
What was his name?
McCoy.
McCoy's moving service. And we even had our own, the drugstore, Mr. James, Mr. Sidney James was his name. And the service station was was a pure oil station at Pettigrew and Fayetteville Street. Now, I didn't know anything about downtown Durham, very little back then, because we didn't have to go downtown.
Okay, I see some questions. It says, is that the Nathaniel White who was one of the first Black students to graduate from Duke? Yes.
Yes, he was.
That is the same one. And where was the school located? If you're talking about Scarborough Nursery School, it was located over near
Pine Street, over near Pine.
Yeah, it was near Pine, but I think it was, there was Cozart and Mobile and Ramsour. It was in that area. I can't remember the exact street, but Mobile was next to Ray Place, then Cozart. So it was in one of those, it seems like I want to say it was on Mobile Avenue where the Scarborough
Nursery. It might have been Mobile. It might have been.
That where the school was located. And
let's see. Well, we hit down.
Mm-hmm. Ask. Oh, the instrument Nat White played, was... I played the clarinet.
And we had had our own restaurants, the Green Candle, and I'm trying to think, it was another one that we had, and the theaters. We had two theaters, the Booker T, and what was the other one's name?
The Regal.
The Regal Theater.
That's pictures of them. Yeah, the Booker T was pretty much a theater where not many African-Americans went to shows there. It was kind of on the upper echelon of theaters on Pettigrew Street. Most of us went on Saturdays to watch the Westerns. They would have like a double matinee.
Yeah.
And going back to the eating places, there was also a place called Miss Pauline's. And I remember a lot of the gospel singers would go there because she would serve meals to them. And there was also a grill downstairs in the Biltmore that serviced soldiers and the singers when they came to town.
Right.
In fact, Tina Turner was one of the performers who stayed at the Biltmore. You could just walk down Pettigrew Street and see the singers standing on the gospel singers.
Yes.
Standing on the outside, soldiers. Pettigrew Street was just crowded from morning to night with people just standing there. There was a hot dog stand, Marvin Best hot dog
Marvin
stand,
Best.
Where you could get hot dogs for probably 10 cents. There was always
delicious.
Always something going on.
All right, it's always something.
Papa Jack's Grill. Yes, it was at Pettigrew, and a lot of people used to go there and buy their beer, and there's the Biltmore Hotel. And they also had a drugstore there too. And we had one up near Elm Street, a pharmacy, Mr. James, Sidney James, where he sold ice cream.
Let's see. And for entertainment, yes, we had the two theaters, but there was also a jazz spot. What was his name? No, we were too young to go to it, but you could stand around on the outside and listen to the music. He had it, I think it was on Whittet Street.
Bub Jones,
right. They had a Birdland Petite or something, I think it was called, jazz music. And I see on there Elvira's Blue Tavern. I just remember that it was Hayti. And it was a situation where if you didn't do right, the neighbor would say, all right, boy, you better, I see you, I know who you are, I know your parents. And sometimes they'd give you a lick, give you a hit, and you got home, you got another one. So it was just Hayti. I had a paper route back then. From Ray Place over the old White Rock Church. The original White Rock Church was on Fayetteville Street. It was in Hayti. Now it's at Fayetteville and Cornwallis. But before that, it was at Fayetteville near Ray Place. And it was one of the few big churches in Durham, White Rock and Oak Grove. They were just all those churches right in Hayti. They were great big churches. The congregations were so big that they had balconies in them that were full and a first floor, and they even spilled over to the basement. They had to put speakers in the basement. It was Hayti, and everybody knew everybody. And they said, "I know your family. I know you, boy. What are you doing?" They kept you on or tried to. Most of them tried to keep you on the straight and narrow. We even had our own taxis, Pine Street Taxi. I remember that. White folks, only thing I remember about them back then was that there were a lot, people had a lot of gardens back then. We had one. And one of my jobs was to, we had chickens. And you knew when the preacher was coming because you had chicken for Sunday. And so my job was, my mother and grandmother, they were real good at wringing a chicken's neck. If you ever seen that done, it's something to see. And one of my jobs was to, after they wrung his neck and killed him, that thing, you know, the chicken's going to run around. And my job was, all right, Bud, they call me Bud, don't let that thing run away. And I had to sit there and watch that chicken run around, watch that body run around, and the eyes of that chicken just be opening and closing. And that was something, but people had gardens and no fence around the garden. You could, that neighborhood, I just remember folks said, that's what they did. They supplemented that. But I was telling you about the white folks coming in the neighborhood, just farmers. We didn't buy a whole lot of, yes, we had grocery cut rate, but farmers came in the neighborhood and they sold meat right off the back of their pickup trucks.
And ice with the
and big ice.
Prongs.
And it has a different taste altogether from what you buy from the store. When you buy fresh cut off the back of that pickup truck, and he was come in, they come in regular. And he fresh cut whatever you want, right off that a slab of meat or whatever it's called, and it was fresh. I remember years later when we started, going to the grocery store to buy food, it didn't taste quite right. Because we had been used to getting fresh from the farmer. And well.
And fresh eggs, we would get eggs, all of that from trucks. As I said, ice, the ice man would come down the street with a big block of ice. And milk, your milk was put in an insulated box on your front porch.
On the front porch.
And it stayed cold, the bottles of milk.
Yes, it did.
And Colonial Stores, this is one of the stores where my father drove long distance trucks for. He was one of the first few African-American long distance drivers. And we remember him going down to Florida and bringing back the pink grapefruit. I had never seen pink grapefruit, but he would bring those back on his trips back home. Those were exciting times. Hayti was just a warm community. You could get your hair done without even going to a shop. There were neighbors who would do your hair in their kitchens. Get your shoes shined. There was a pool room.
There
were horses in the field that was down the street from us. And Mr. Lee, who couldn't be here today, he wasn't feeling well. He would take those horses, he told us, every week to get them shod. He remembered that. Mr. Evans was the man's name who had the horses. I don't know why his name just came to me. But it was just wooded areas. There were little neighborhood stores where you could go in and buy your penny candy.
Smitty's.
A nickel you would buy, have a bag full of cookies, bread Smitty's. For 5 cents.
Right.
And we were little children, you know, we just saw all of this in these stores. We didn't have to go far to shop. Everything was right there at your hands.
What I remember in the summer months when it was hot, that you slept halfway, we always slept closer to the floor, but with the front door open. We had screen doors. And that was just a common thing in that neighborhood. The front doors was open. I remember seeing black police officers, but just passing through. No, you slept with the front doors open, and because at some point we moved from the bathrooms out in the backyard. And somehow, and I remember it was a big convenience thing having the bathroom attached to the back of the house. I thought that was great. instead of going out there in the winter, going out of that thing away from the house and the bathroom attached to the back of the house, I said, this is great. And he'll say something, the pool room was Jabadee's pool room, and we weren't allowed in the front door, but you could go in the back door, and Mr. Rome ran the shoe shop up the street. And all those people corrected you. They had, if you weren't, they knew you or they knew your family. They would say, all right, boy, well, I see you now. And I said, yes, sir. And it was a yes, sir, no, sir, three bags full. You know, you didn't, this thing that happened over here in Raleigh last night, that blew me, well, that's another story. But I was a kid. I don't know in the world a kid could be at a youngest could be at this age and be that mad. But anyway, but now we didn't know anything about guns back then. A gun, you know, a buddy of mine, Joe Williams, said some one time, they were somewhere and a guy had a gun. Joe said, a gun? I said, what is that? We didn't know anything about guns. We watched. Hill said something about going to the theaters. we watched Hopalong Cassidy, and Lash LaRue. I don't know if you ever heard of those old cowboy movies, serials. You know, they show up to a point, and then like he was getting ready to fall off the cliff, and then when you come back again the next week, you said, wait a minute, he was about to fall off the cliff last week. What happened there? Well, we went for it. So,
I'm sorry, I don't need to talk to you. Someone asked a question about what chores we did. All of us did chores. My mother was very strict.
Oh, yeah, everybody had a job. That
every Friday, we dusted furniture. We would have two cloths. One would be dry and one would be damp. And you would use the dry cloth to dust the furniture first, and then the damp cloth to make sure that you got everything, all of the dust, thinking that the dust would adhere to the damp cloth. I remember we had wood floors with rugs on them, but the wood floors, I remember that we would put a brick, like a brick from outside.
Yes.
And a woolen sweater. And we would put that polish on the floor to clean them. And then we would put this paste down in order to polish them. And we had on our socks. And we would take that brick in that woolen cloth and slide all the way across that floor back and forth until it was shining like
that's right.
Glass.
I remember that.
That was our exercise. We worked inside the house. Now this picture here, the Carolina Theater. It was a different time, of course. African Americans sat upstairs, and I'll tell you, it seemed like there were about 500 steps going up those stairs. It was just a long way up to the top. So we very seldom went to the Carolina. Our theater was the Regal, and sometimes very seldom the Booker T. But there weren't very many African Americans who went to the Carolina Theater on a regular basis. And as I said, there were just so many steps to climb in the section where African Americans were mandated to sit.
That's true. Yes,
now,
sir.
This is a picture of Fable Street Projects. That's what it was known as when they built it. We moved as little children to Umstead Street, right across from where Fable Street Projects would be constructed in 1956. And years after they built the projects, my grandmother was one of the first ones that moved to one of the apartments. Mm. They had lived on Elm Street, up the street from us when we lived on Elm Street. I think it was the first time with central air and heat.
Yeah.
Fable Street Projects. There were stairs there, but on Elm Street, practically everyone was using wood and coal stoves. No furnaces even existed for African Americans on our street. But when they moved there, of course, you know, they thought, oh, well, we've moved up because now we don't have to get in wood and coal and have to open a window up by putting a stick in it to hold it up if the sash in the window broke. So this was an improvement for a lot of the families. I see someone who says they work at Carolina Theater and there were about 90 steps. But you know, when you're young, you really think it's more steps than it is. But even at 90 steps, that's a lot of steps to go and see a movie. And the person says there is an exhibit there with all of this information. But I guess, you know, our house is still on Umstead Street. Across the street, there is a a lot of debris, wire fences, overgrowth from when the projects was dismantled. And as you see, the old areas where there was family in 1950s, now in Hayti in 2008, you'd hardly even know your neighbors. Everyone is more isolated. Because of course, there's more crime, there are more cars, you have to drive so far to get to a store. Everything now is much different than it was in the 50s. I would like to go back to the 50s in a way. Things weren't as modern or technologically improved, but it was a simple life where everyone tried to help everyone. We live next door to a family on Elm Street where there were a lot of kids. And I remember the mother wearing her husband's shoes all the time. And they weren't as financially advantaged as we were. We didn't even know what it was to be poor. I always said we were low middle class because we didn't know what it was to be without. We never went hungry. We always had clothes. We always had
always had something to eat.
A nice place to stay in the scheme of things. Yes, it was Elm Street. It was a wooden structure. It wasn't a shotgun, but all of us were still neighbors. It was, as Bud said, yes, ma'am. Yes, yes, sir. Hey, Miss Mary. Hey, Mr. John. It was never, hey, John. Hey, Mary. We were expected to respect our elders. It was understood that this is what was going to happen. You did not disrespect anyone. You played with some of the kids, played together, went to school. Bud was talking about neighbors knowing your names and your parents' names in the schools. Prof. Austin, he said, yeah, I know your mama. I'm a call Miss Mary Smith. It was just that sense of family wherever you went.
Hilda said something. Now Hilda said something about doing chores. That reminded me. I said I had a paper route, but one of my chores, I said, about watching the chicken. But the other one was separating. We used to get the farmers would come through, and they would give you would buy a bag. I mean, not a paper bag. I mean, a bag of beans that they picked up out of their fields. And one of my jobs was to separate the little pebbles out of it. You get a bag of beans that last you. Oh man, you get tired of eating them. But and my job was to, as you said, put them out on the table, separate the little pebbles out of it, because the folks will warn you. Say, all right now. When we get to cooking these things, if I back down on a rock, I'm gonna tell you what butt up. So that my job was to make sure got all the pebbles and rocks out of those beans so they were cooked. But now Hill is correct. You had to, not that you, it was bred into you to be respectful of people and mindful of what other folks were doing. And yes, sir, and no, sir, and I didn't feel like we were poor because everybody around you was in the same shape that you were in. And a lot of gardens on the street. And the preacher says, no big me and no little you. It was just, we're all the same. We all walked to school together. Shirley Caesar sings that song about going to school with a greasy bag. Sometimes you didn't because you had something, sometimes you didn't. You know, you could get to eat for, I think, what was it, Hill, about a nickel or a quarter. it wasn't much, but what you wanted was milk. And the farmers would bring you milk or the dairy farmer they put it in a container on your front porch. So, no, it was a lot of times I think about those days, and it was two horses at the bottom of the street. Man, he would plow a field. And Hilda asked about that earlier. I think that might have been Moline. I don't know what the name of that street, but I had a paper route that went from Ray Price through St. Joseph Street and all around there. And you knew everybody and they knew you. And one of the things, all right, I know you now. I'm calling to hear your folks on you. So that always scared me straight anyway.
And someone asked the question about the race of the people who brought the food on the street or sold it on the food. I remember that the people who brought like the chickens in crates and eggs, they were white.
Right.
But Lewis who brought, and the person who had brought the milk was white, but the Lewis who had the ice truck, he was black.
Right.
I just remembered that. And the owners of the grocery stores were white, cut rate. Johnson's Fish Market, they were African-American. The majority of the businesses on Fayetteville Street in Hayti were African-American. There was Mr. Dooms, had a hat shop. The shoe shine shop, all of those were African-American. There was a dry cleaners, Scott and Roberts. The person who worked there was African-American, but Scott and Roberts was a white establishment. But then, of course, the Weaver brothers established the dry cleaners, and they were African-American. But 90%, 99% of the businesses in that area were African-American owned.
Oh, yeah. Long's Florist, Yabadee's Pool Room at the insurance company on the what is mutual now that's closed, had a little shop on the corner right there at Pettigrew Street. It was a small bank. At least 95 or plus black folk owned all those businesses. And on Sunday, Mr., everything came to a standstill. You knew it was Sunday, because if you weren't in church, something was wrong with it. You had to be sick. I see you, Laura.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Normally we have someone come on to ask questions, but Hilda, you are so great at keeping up with the chat. And the person who normally helps us is helping Milton right now, that we made it happen. So thank you so much. It's several people put this in the chat. This is truly my favorite time of the month, getting to hear from you all, whether or not we were alive then or whether or not we've ever lived in Hayti. I think people really identify with the things you talk about, or they want to be a part of the things that you talk about. So thank you so much for that.
And thank you so much again for having us. And thanks to all of the listeners for being interested enough in Hayti to hear how it was way back then. Thank you, all of you.